come to St. Paul's on this, the second Sunday of Lent. The service of morning prayer begins on page 38 of your books of common prayer, or on page 1 of your service bulletin. If we say that we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sin, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. But thou, O Lord, have mercy on us. Spare thou those who confess their faults. Restore thou those who are penitent. According to thy promises, declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. The Almighty and merciful Lord grant us absolution and remission of all our sins, true repentance, amendment of life, and the grace and consolation of his Holy Spirit. Amen. O Lord, lift up thou our lips,
and our mouths shall show forth thy praise.
Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Venite, found on page 44 of the Book of Common Prayer, or page 2 of your service bulletin. O come, let us sing unto the Lord. Let us heartily rejoice in the strength of our salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving, and show ourselves glad in him with psalms. For the Lord is a great God, and a great King above all gods. In his hand are all the corners of the earth, and the strength of the hills is his also. The sea is his, and he made it, and his hands prepare the dry land. O come, let us worship and fall down, and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is the Lord our God, and we are the people of his pasture, and the sheep of his hand. O worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Let the whole earth stand in awe of him. For he cometh to judge the earth, and with righteousness to judge the world, and the peoples with his truth. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
The psalm appointed for today is Psalm 22, verses 22 to 30, found on page 611 of the Book of Common Prayer, or on page 2 of the service bulletin. Let us read in unison. Praise the Lord, you that fear him. Stand in awe of him, O offspring of Israel. All you of Jacob's line, give glory. For he does not despise nor lower the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. But when they cry to him, he hears them. My praise is of him in the great assembly. I will praise The Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I am God Almighty. Walk before me and be blameless, and I will make my covenant between me and you, and will make you exceedingly numerous. Then Abram fell on his face, and God said to him, as for me, this is my covenant with you. You shall be the ancestor of a multitude of nations. No longer shall your name be Abram, but your name shall be Abraham. For I have made you the ancestor of a multitude of nations. I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nations of you, and kings shall come from you. I will establish my covenant between me and you and your offspring after you throughout their generations for an everlasting covenant to be God to you and to your offspring after you. God said to Abraham, as for Sarai, your wife, you shall not call her Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name. I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall give rise to nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read together a song of praise found on page 49 of the Book of Common Prayer or on page 3 of the service bulletin. Blessed art thou, O Lord God of our fathers, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou for the name of thy majesty, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou in the temple of thy holiness, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou that beholdest the depths and dwellest between the cherubim, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou on the glorious throne of thy kingdom, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou in the firmament of heaven, praised and exalted above all forever. Blessed art thou, O Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, praised and exalted above all forever. A reading from St. Paul's letter to the Romans. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null, and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there a violation. For this reason, it depends on the faith in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made you the father of many nations, in the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old. Or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distress made him waver concerning the promise of God, but he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words that was reckoned to him were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. all people, to be a light to lighten the Gentiles, and to be the glory of thy people Israel. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. A reading from the Gospel according to Mark. Jesus began to teach his disciples that the Son of Man must undergo great suffering and be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, and be killed, and after 3 days rise again. He said all this quite openly. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But turning and looking at his disciples, he rebuked Peter and said, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." He called the crowd with his disciples and said to them, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake and for the sake of the gospel will save it. For what will it profit them to gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Indeed, what can they give in return for their life? Those who are ashamed of me and of my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, of them the Son of Man will also be ashamed when he comes in the glory of his Father with the holy angels." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. I must begin with something of a confession here. I misread the lectionary for this particular Sunday, and instead of the Old Testament lesson that you just heard, I had gone on the basis of the lesson regarding the sacrifice of Isaac. So please bear with me on that score. Most of us are familiar with pictures that look different depending on how one looks at them. The rabbit that becomes the duck, the goblin that unexpectedly transforms into two people facing each other, or the cube, which at one moment pointing down and to the left, and the next up and to the right. Perspective changes things. What we expect to find changes what we actually see. Pairing the story of the near sacrifice of Isaac with our gospel lesson seems to have this effect. Normally, we hear this pivotal event as concerning Abraham and his faith. But when one compares Isaac's trek up Mount Moriah with Jesus' journey to Jerusalem, Isaac starts to come into view. So let us use our imagination a bit. Imagine yourself as Isaac, foot of the mountain. You, Abraham, a servant, and a donkey have been trudging along with what seems to be forever. You have with you wood and live charcoal. You know what these things are for, and it is not for roasting marshmallows and singing camp songs. Something vital, however, is missing. Namely, the main reason for the sojourn, a sacrificial animal. Now, we know that Abraham has flocks. Nice things. Why is there no lamb, no ram, no ewe tagging along? Perhaps Abraham, out of affection for his flock, just couldn't part with one of them. But his had been a long trip, and there had been plenty of opportunity to purchase an animal along the way. Nevertheless, there they were, beginning their climb, leaving the servant and the donkey and carrying the fire and the wood. Isaac may have been a bit queasy about things before, but now something close to him must have set in. Even so, it is only now that Isaac confronts his father. Why did he wait so long? As odd as it may sound, may have been out of love and respect. In a culture where honor is highly valued, Isaac would not put his father to the shame of asking an awkward question in front of a servant. And even at that, his question shows deference. "I see the fire," says Isaac, "and the wood. Where's the lamb?" And what is Abraham's reply? "God will provide." Isaac may be many things, but he is no fool. He has heard the stories about how his father passed his mother off as his sister, twice as a matter of fact. And the old man got away with it. Love his father, but he knows that when push comes to shove, Abraham is a very good liar. He knows the signs. As far as Isaac is concerned, his father is covering up some terrible truth with happy heart. Now we come to Jesus and Peter. Gospel lesson. Jesus has just announced to his disciples in no uncertain terms that he is going to Jerusalem, where he will be arrested, tried, convicted, and crucified. Peter's response to this is that Jesus must be crazy to think so such a thing. Arrest and crucifixion just is not part of the program. Even if things get dicey, God will find some way out, surely. Things will work out. But Peter is simply engaging in the same sort of happy talk that Abraham was, hoping that by doing so, he, and perhaps Jesus, can avoid the hard truth of the matter. Jesus, on the other hand, is having nothing to do with this, and cuts Peter off before the lie has a chance to fester. God is trusting Jesus with the truth, and so Jesus is able to face the hard reality. But why is Jesus so harsh with Peter? In essence, Jesus is saying to Peter, "You think I'm crazy? Take a look in the mirror." Jesus knows that Peter can face the truth, a truth that he does not want to acknowledge, but must. Because if such a lie persists, when it fails, it would destroy Peter. Out of love, Jesus calls Peter out. Now going back to Isaac, let us continue to assume that Isaac does not for a moment accept Abraham's attempt to put him off. There is not a word of protest recorded. Isaac continues up the mountain when he could have easily headed back. For all we know, he could have helped arrange the wood for the pyre. child, and by then, Abraham was somewhere around 100. What was to stop Isaac from simply turning him around? And here we can only guess. Perhaps, although human sacrifice was abhorrent to Abraham's later descendants, it was practiced by the people of Isaac's time. Perhaps Isaac saw it as somehow necessary. And while we would rightly condemn such an action in the strongest terms, Isaac had his reasons. And part of that reason must have been connected to the love that he had for his father and the hope that some good would come out of this, even if it were not for him. The parallel to Christ's passion is striking, but is that the only parallel? Not at all. Almost without pause, Jesus declares that whoever would be a disciple must take up their own cross to, if you will, climb one's own Mount Moriah. If Jesus started with an uncomfortable truth, he completely pulls the rug out of our complacent existence with a devastating one. And it would seem to go against a good deal of popular theology. After all, in redeeming us on the cross, did not Jesus do precisely what we could never do for ourselves? The answer to this conundrum is in the sort of cross our Lord intended for us to bear. Recall that in carrying one's cross, we are to deny ourselves. That is, to acknowledge in the very core of our being that we are not for ourselves alone, but for one another. And to follow him. That is, to imitate Jesus. So then, what sort of cross are we to bear? I would submit that the cross that Jesus took up daily, the cross that Jesus would have us bear, is the cross of love. It is the cross that moved Jesus to feed the 5,000, to heal the sick, to teach his disciples, to confront the powers that be, regardless of the cost. It is that cross of love that gave the cross of wood and the nails of iron any meaning or value. It is the cross of love that makes any of the so-called crosses we have to bear of any worth. It is this cross that leads to reconciliation, understanding, to an advocacy that goes beyond mere ideals but is founded on the concrete nature of our shared experience, because we have opened ourselves to one another and realized what we easily confess to be true, that we are capable of loving one another and of being loved. We know how both these stories end. At the last possible instant, God stays Abraham's hand and does indeed provide a ram. And we believe, as the creed says, that Jesus suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and that on the third day he rose again from the dead. But just as Jesus was still on the road to Jerusalem then, we are still on our road. Just like Isaac, we are climbing our own mountain. And the exact end, with all its anxieties, is not certain. The road may be rough, the climb steep, far harder for some and steeper than it would be for others. But while we are on this path, us each take up the cross of love together. It is the burden of love that makes this journey worthwhile. And should we set it aside, let us each take it back again. For this Jesus, who loved us then so long ago, loves us still, and will see to it that he brings us home together.
Let us affirm our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God,
the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
The Lord be with you,
and with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
O Lord, show thy mercy upon us,
and grant us thy salvation.
Endue thy ministers with righteousness,
and make thy chosen people joyful.
Give peace, O Lord, in all the world.
For only in thee can we live in safety.
Lord, keep this nation under thy care,
and guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let thy way be known upon earth,
thy saving health among all nations.
Let not the needy, O Lord, be forgotten,
nor the hope of the poor be taken away.
Create in us clean hearts, O God,
and sustain us with thy Holy Spirit.
O God, whose glory it is always to have mercy, be gracious to all who have gone astray from thy ways, and bring them again with penitent hearts and steadfast faith to the embrace and hold faith fast to the unchangeable truth of thy word, Jesus Christ, thy Son, who with thee in the Holy Spirit liveth and reigneth, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen. O God, who art the author of peace and lover of concord, in knowledge of whom standeth our eternal life, whose service is perfect freedom, defend us, thy humble servants, in all assaults of our enemies, that we, surely trusting in thy defense, may not fear the power of any adversary, through the might of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. O Heavenly Father, in whom we live and move and have our being, we humbly pray thee so to guide and govern us by thy Holy Spirit, that in all the cares and occupations of our life we may not forget thee, but remember that we are ever walking in thy sight, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The General Thanksgiving. Almighty God,
Father of all mercies, unworthy servants to give thee most humble and hearty thanks for all thy goodness and loving kindness to us and to all men. We bless thee for our creation, preservation, and all the blessings of this life, but above all for thine inestimable love and the redemption of the world by our Lord Jesus Christ, for the means of grace and for the hope of glory. And we beseech thee, give us that due sense of all thy mercies, that our hearts may be unfeignedly thankful, and that we show forth thy praise not only with our lips, but in our lives, by giving up ourselves to thy service, and by walking before thee in holiness and righteousness all our days. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
A prayer of St. Chrysostom. Almighty God,
who hast given us grace at this time, with one accord, to make our common supplication unto thee, and hast promised through the royal beloved Son that when two or three are gathered together in his name, thou wilt be in the midst of them. Fulfill now, O Lord, the desires and petitions of thy servants as may be best for us, granting us in this world knowledge of thy truth, and in the world to come,
life everlasting.
Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Amen.